Amen and amen. It is good to be in the house of the Lord on this morning. I'm excited. As you've seen on the videos, I've been praying for this day, not simply because it's Youth and Children's Day, but simply because we invited some friends about a program we were doing on Monday nights. We simply wanted to open our gym and partner with some organizations that simply love kids and have the same passion as we do to simply care for them. You know, Monday nights we've been having the beauty of just seeing young men play some basketball, and some people will say, what's basketball? What did that have to do with it? Well, you haven't came on Monday. See, on Monday nights, it's not just about basketball, but it's about loving individuals simply because we want them to know it's a safe place to come. We're going to love them exactly for who they are, and we're going to share God's word. And we just thank Pastor and New Hope for opening their doors to be able to serve them. And I thank them young men for coming and being committed to being here with us and allowing us to speak life in those families, about 200 and some families that come. I do. So I've been praying, and I believe the Lord has given me a word for us this morning. So please be praying for me. Let me pray now, and I'll get into what God has to say for us on this morning. Let's pray. Father God, I do indeed thank you this morning. Father, I simply ask that you would decrease me and increase your spirit within me. Let me only speak the words that you want me to speak. Let my flesh move totally out of the way. Father, I ask that you would open my ears, that you would open everyone's in here's ears, that they would hear a word from you. Edify us on this morning. Let us sit, Father God, before you. And let us feel your love like never before on this morning, that it would forever change us. It is in Jesus' name I do pray. Amen. This morning, as we started, as Pastor has said, I'm so excited. Zachary is back there on the microphone, and we had our youth ushers. As you've seen, we had our youth activated and moving. Our beautiful young ladies, man, Dr. Lars be doing some work, don't she? Them two young ladies tore it up. I mean, we got some rising stars. But God is doing something here at New Hope Baptist Church that causes us to think about this message on today of love. Let's turn with me to the first book of John. 1 John chapter 4. 1 John chapter 4. Now, John is like a father, like myself. John is writing this kind of like a conversation. And I want us to have a conversation this morning because it's youth. As you know, I don't want to do 3 points and messages, and I want this. I want to just come and have a conversation with you, if that is all right with you on this morning. I'm kind of in the spirit of John, that I just want to be a father that is concerned about his children. I want to be a father that loves his children. And so when I love my children and if I have a message for them, I simply want to sit them down and share with them from my very heart. And so John has me in that moment this morning. And we're going to start at verse number 7. And I want you to listen to these words carefully. Dear friends, let us love one another, for love comes from God. Let's go back there. Hold on. For love comes from God. Everyone who loves has been born of God and knows God. Whoever does not love does not know God. Whoever does not love does not know God. Whoever does not love does not know God, because God is love. This is how God showed his love among us. He sent his one and only Son into the world that we might live through him. This is the love, not that we love God, not that we love God, not that we love God, but that he loved us and sent his Son as an atoning sacrifice for our sins. Dear friends, since God so loved us, we also ought to love one another. Man, that is powerful. We also, because he first loved us, we must love others also. Man, do you love your brothers and sisters in the room? But if we love one another, God lives in us, and his love is made complete in us. This is how we know that we live in him, he in us. He has given us the Spirit, and we have seen and testified that the Father has sent his Son to be the Savior of the world. If anyone acknowledges that Jesus is the Son of God, God lives in them and they in God. And so we know and rely on the love God has for us. Amen. So for this morning, I just want us to think about this. The source of all love is God, for God is love. The source of all love is God, for God is love. Now, for most of y'all, this is the first time if you talk to me. I kind of like to have some illustrations. I like to bounce around a little bit. But simply, that's how I talk with my kids. And so I want to take us back to the beginning in Genesis about a little story for just a little bit. And because I tried to do the best, we got the flowers, we're in the garden. And so this is my little setup for us for just a little bit. This is the Garden of Eden, you know, back in the day where God created the heavens and the earth. He created the birds. He created man and woman. And so everything was good in the garden. Everything was peaceful. Everything was lovely. I mean, this is the time that Adam and Eve, they spent with God. Y'all read this. Y'all know this. This is where he said in the cool of the day, they just spent time loving on one another, coming and dressing in. They didn't know anything. They just simply said, whatever we need, Mike, God has. Ain't that good? Whatever we need, whatever our source is, whatever we want, we can just simply ask for and we'll have it. He has given them dominion, and there's love and there's peace. And so in the cool of the day, they were able to sit back and wait and come, and God is coming, and they have a face-to-face encounter. They have time that they're simply just sharing. They're naked before God. I hope anybody in here simply wants to be naked before God, because they can simply share all of their cares, because he will simply love them no matter what. See, this is the place that we want to be. This is the place where real love is, that God is simply just here. Face to face. Man, we're able to do this. But man, y'all read Genesis, something happened. Oh my goodness. Serpent come up into this. Here comes the enemy. Slick, smooth, and crafty. All of a sudden, the family, the good family that was communion together, they wasn't lying to each other. They was talking to one another. They was spending time. They was on and just gazing. Y'all know those that's been married for a while. You just holding hand. Everything all good. It's beautiful. But all of a sudden, something changed their relationship. And so all of a sudden, here comes this crafty man, this little slivery guy that says something to Eve that gets Eve to do something outside of what God told her and her husband to do. Oh, but watch this. Adam there, you know, he chilling. Hey, what's up? This is beautiful in the garden. But Adam drops the ball. Adam does not take his place as the man and the head of the house and lead his family in the obedience of what God has called him to do. And when he's asked about it, this ain't y'all. This just me and Adam. What happened? Well, you see, God, the woman you gave me.
This woman you gave, see, it was her fault. See, I was just over here trying to be obedient, but the woman you gave me, we start shifting blame. See, all of a sudden it was love. We were face to face. We could commune. We were naked before each other. We were sharing everything. But all of a sudden, we shifted. There's a break in the relationship. There's a break in our love, our connection. And all of a sudden now when God comes in, he got to say, man, hold on. Adam, where are you? Where you at? Now, God knows all. He ain't confused where you at. He knows exactly where you are. See, this is us. Where you at? Because it's a break in our communication. It's a break in our love. It's a break somewhere. So I'm asking where you at? Because I'm always initiating as God. I'm always seeking. I'm always watching. I'm always concerned about my children. But what does that don't do? I think he does what I do, not y'all. He go hide. Man, God, ooh. Where you gonna hide from God? So he start covering up like he's in the dark. He's covering up like he can hide from God. You in the dark. Trying to hide from God. Like he don't see you. But watch. But from this point, there's a disconnect because we allow someone to take our source, which is God, our one that we were getting all of our nutrients, everything from. We had somebody else begin to speak to us. This slivery guy became a new source. And when that new source came to speak, different things happened. And all of a sudden, for the first time, we are doing something outside of our character. We once sat in light, now we're sitting in darkness. All of a sudden, we're sitting in fear. We're sitting where we can't be open. No longer can I come before God naked and open and saying, here's all of me. Now all of a sudden I have to try and cover something up. It's just me. I don't know about you, but I know some adults and young people that simply want to just cover some things up and they don't want you to really know them for who they are. So they simply cover themselves. So all of a sudden, we don't have the same relationship that God desired for us to have. And now, because we think we can't share and be honest, I'm trying to say I'm going to move myself away. Here's the image I want you to look at. Here's where we are in the 21st century. This is where we are sometimes in our connection with the Father. And I know what some of y'all thinking. What this got to do with love? I'm going to bring it home, I guarantee you. So let's bring it forward. Lights up, 24th century. We chilling. Want to share a story with you. Here's this young pastor, new pastor. Man, new congregation. Got a search team. They like, man, we got to find a pastor. Sure enough, they got a candidate. He come in. Man, he looks sharp. Oh, I'm so excited. Congregation's packed. They in the house. Get up, first sermon. Man, sure enough, he knocked it out the box. It was good. They were like, man, pastor's a keeper. This one a keeper. Good. Man, come back next week. Man, everybody waiting. Pastor, open up. Same scripture. Same message. Word for word. They're like, all right, new pastor, I understand. I got it. He trying to get us to get the message. I'm with you. I hear you. Benefit of the doubt. Next Sunday, cue. Come in. Hey, I know, Lamar, I know we're going to hear something from Pastor this time. Open the text, same message. Same message. They like, man, is it me? Or is he preaching the same thing again? So they say, no, I ain't going to say nothing. Maybe he just don't know and he really wants us to get it. So we going to hang in there one more time. For Sunday. Pastor comes. Man, it's a good morning, y'all. I got a message for you. I've been praying. The Lord gave me a message for you. Open with the same message. They heated now. So before he can even get going, you know, the deacon's sitting in the front row. He got started for one deacon. Hey, hold, pastor, we get it. We got you. What is it? What do we got to do to get you past this message? He says, simple. Do it. Let me tell you what verse he was preaching from. See, because sometimes church folk run you out of here. He just says simply, read 1 John 4:11. Beloved, if God loves us, in this way we also ought to love one another. All I need you to do is love one another. If you can love one another, I can move on to the next message. But what he was trying to get them to understand, the moral of it is that I need you to not just do by coming to church. Oh, Brother Q, what are you talking about? Don't just come to church. You can come to church. Oh, man, that was a good message. Man, Pastor preached today. Boy, that was so good. Man, I'm telling you, leave the church. Go out. Do exactly the opposite of what he just preached. Now, you're going to tell everybody it was a great sermon. Everybody, it was good. Wednesday come, Bible study. Man, poof, can't come. Too much going on. So we miss it. I don't want to hit nobody. But we miss what he's actually calling us to do. Because the only way that we know how to love is that is God is our source. So here's this. Face it. Sometimes we don't feel like we're very loving. Be honest. Some folks, it's a lot easier to love than other folks. You honest? We got some people that you just don't love. Y'all don't want to say nothing because you don't want nobody seeing you shake. It's some family members. You like, I got to love them. Lord Jesus, you just don't know. But I ain't say it, he said it. Because if you think about what he had to go through, man, he shouldn't have died for me. I'm no good. I turned my back on him. I didn't come. I ain't do what I had to do. But he died for me. And he just told me to love folk. Because he first loved me. And if I'm a Christian and I said, I'm following him, then I must love others. So here's the question for us today. What's your source? What source, excuse me, does your love come from? What source does your love come from? See, this morning I would like for us to look behind the scenes to love one another as God loves us. In order that we might redirect what is the source of love. And in so doing, tap into the wellspring of love that is both encompassing of all those we meet and enduring over the changing seasons of our lives. How many of us know we have some changing seasons in our lives? God took me through some changes. He's taking me through some now. But in the midst of that, he's still a loving God. But I won't know it if I'm not tapped into the source. If I'm not tapped into who he is, I will lose my mind. So let's begin with looking at the first two verses here of our text today. Beloved, beloved, let us love one another, for love is God, and everyone who loves is born of God and knows God. He who does love God does not love God doesn't know God, for God is love. That's what it says. If you want the sermon title for today, it's simply this: the source of all love is God, for God is love. I don't have anything else for you. The source of love is God, for God is love. The source of all love is God, for God is love. It sounds obvious, doesn't it? Yet it is not, because unconditionally we believe somehow that the source of love is within us. That we have the capacity to love separate and apart from God. This is the subject of endless songs, movies, romance novels, and all of these, hey, I love this woman, and I love this man, and all of these reality TV shows. Y'all see them. Y'all watch them. Y'all ain't going to tell nobody. The Bachelorette and all that, you know what I'm saying? I don't care how you date eight women at the same time and then try and figure out love. I'm going to leave that alone. We talk about love or friends and family, patriotism of the country, except those of religious persuasion. It is if God does not have anything to do with all of that. Have we left God out of what love really is? I can't love my friend or love my wife or my children at our first loving Christ. When you think about it, the word love for us is generic. It's a generic term, you know. Y'all see some people. Man, I love you, bro. Man, I love this ice cream, man. You ever had that chocolate chip? Man, I'm telling you, that chocolate chip, put a little chocolate on there with some whipped cream. Man, I love it. See, we hear it. See, young people hear love all the time. They hear love all the time. They hear love all the time. They hear love all the time. But do they experience love? It can refer to a feeling powerful enough to cause us to do some crazy things. You ever done some crazy things in the name of love? You know, just ridiculous. You know, when you're a teenager, you do some dumb stuff. Man, I love her. Oh, no, you love. You know, some people marry, but that one's done. They loved him. It was eventual, but they were rough at first. And it can cause us easily to refer to the devotion to an individual group that demands loyalty, fidelity, commitment, and sacrifice. Love can be fickle. It can be this thing like we can just say it so easily and forget its meaning. What it really means to love someone. One with the God kind of love. That is something to think about. See, as poets, as writers, as many people that have tried to describe it, but let me share with you how Paul writes it. Love is patient. Love is kind. Love doesn't envy. Love doesn't brag. It is not proud. Doesn't behave itself inappropriate. It doesn't seek its own way. It is not provoked. Takes no account of evil. Doesn't rejoice in their unrighteousness. But rejoices with the truth. Bears all things. Believes all things. Hopes all things. Endures all things. Because love never fails. That's what Paul said in 1 Corinthians. I ain't said that's what Paul said. See, often this passion, this text, line of wedding service. Man, that's my text right there, boy. Got to share that at the wedding. Then you come back like, man, 2 years from now, whoo. Y'all want to come back in and read that text again? See, we laughing, but it's serious. The divorce rate is high. It's quick to get up front. But now it's some work to put in love. Often, the fact, as much as we might think of love in this way, this is hardly the description of love we know. See, our experience of love is often anything but patient and kind. We are prone to jealousy when someone we love shows too much love and attention to somebody else. Come on, somebody tell us the truth. Why you do that for me? You didn't do that for me. Don't have a secretary. You do something like, you ain't never got me no flowers. Taking somebody else out to lunch, you ain't never took me to lunch. See, I'm making fun, but you see what I'm saying. We do some things and we can quickly get jealous. We cannot help boasting when we do something extraordinary or being arrogant and rude when others fall short of our expectations. Sometimes, you know, you laugh at somebody, man, I told they was going to mess up. I told them don't do it, but they ain't want to listen. See, look at them now. We do that. And see, God is saying, I want to check where your love is. Most of us from about age 2 want to do things our own way. 2 to 22. Maybe up to 32. And we tend to get pretty irritable, resentful, when we are forced into submission to others. We would like to think that we generally wish the best for others. But if we're honest with ourselves, we cannot help but snicker, laugh, when some big shot gets what's coming to them. When we see that family member fail, when we see that marriage fail, when we see that kid, if they would have just stayed home like I told them, we kind of feel a little rejoiced sometimes. All this to say, I believe what Paul is describing in 1 Corinthians is a different kind of love. It has to be something different from what we see and experience every day. How do you explain this? The answer is simply this. Humanly speaking, we don't have the capacity to love separate and apart from God. Let me say that again. See, the answer is easy. We don't have the capacity to love separate and apart from God. We can feel infatuation. We can feel, we can practice reciprocity. We can feel and practice saying this love over and over. But yet, we cannot do it without being tapped in to God. See, the good news is this. When we're willing to place God at the center of our lives, God's love fills our hearts, gives us the grace to love one another, not just in part for a moment, but fully, intimately, completely, and forever. See, back here in the garden, when God was loving intimately, let me slow that down, into me you see, intimacy. See, when you have intimacy, into me you will see all of my flaws, all of my mess, everything that I am. I can come before you boldly, nakedly, and God still loves you because no matter what, hey, you coming to me, I am your source. This is where you get all of your nutrients. This is where you can come and totally be naked. And I love you for it. You don't have to cover up. You don't have to lie. You don't have to go away. You don't have to sit in darkness. But oh, we got to be tapped in to the right source. Only such love as this comes from our Father. Therefore, contrary to what the world would have us to believe, the source of love is not within us. It is within the very being of God. God is love, and he who remains in his love remains in God, and God in him. That's 1 John 4:16. See, having said that, we should hasten to add, God's love is anything but abstract. Perhaps love is a concept, an ideal, a principle on which we basically have lofty goals or philosophies or notions in our head. However, in the Christian faith, Christ-like faith, Christian really is Christ-like faith, God's love is concrete and specific. In the words of our text today, by this God's love was revealed in us, that God has sent his one and only Son into the world that we might live through him. And this love, not that we love God, but that he loved us and sent his Son for the atoning sacrifices for our sins. See, this death and this resurrection of Jesus is the starting place to lift our devotion to God and his servants to others. And this source of our ability to love God, neighbors, and ourselves. Because Christ died for our sins, we are free to live in gratitude for God and share the good news for forgiveness with others. Because through Christ, we are reconciled to God. We are free to offer the possibility of reconciliation to others. That's what we're doing on Monday nights. We're just simply offering God's love. We're simply placing the seed, one might water, but God ultimately gives the increase. But we must do our part first. Moreover, because in Christ, God supplies the things we need. Let me say that again. God supplies the things we need. Some of us need so many things and we find it in wrong places. Sometimes we're looking for love in all the wrong places. Y'all know what I'm saying. But we didn't look to God, because God supplies all things we need for the full and abundant life that we're all aspiring to live. We are free to reach out to others in the name of Jesus Christ with his gift and kindness and generosity. The truth in the word, we love him because he first loved us. That's what John 4:19 says. The tangible proof of God's love is this, that he died and he resurrected. God died. He sent his only begotten son that you and I might have the opportunity to be connected back to him. God's love is anything but abstract. It is concrete and specific. This is the way we are called to love one another, not with gushy feelings or with our deeds. Because sometimes, if we're honest, I'm doing the right thing. I'm not a bad guy. I do all the right things. I'm just good. I'm going to go to the church, pay my tithes. I'm going to help the pastor out every once in a while. When he say volunteer, I'm going to volunteer. Not going to do it too much, but I'm going to do it a little. I'm a good guy. But here's this. Mike, where you at? You got it?
Here, yep.
But I want you to watch this.
Matthew 7:21. Not everyone who says to me, Lord, Lord, will enter the kingdom of heaven, but only who does the will of my Father who is in heaven. Many will say to me on that day, Lord, Lord, did we not prophesy in your name? Mm-hmm. And in your name drive out demons and perform many miracles?
Man.
Then I will tell them plainly, I never knew you.
Man.
Away from me, you evildoers.
What you say? What? Man, I mean, I'm coming to church and I'm helping people, and he might say he never knew me? Man, what does that make me think of? See, back in here, this meant something with Adam. This relationship we had to have. See, love has to do with relationship, not just knowing of information. You can go to school and know a lot of information. Just because you know God doesn't mean I know about God, but I don't know him to the intimacy. Intimacy. I don't have this relationship because I'm truly not plugged into him. I know release. I know that's what Pastor was talking about. Y'all want to get released into this world to do what God has called you. But in order to do that, you got to be plugged into the source, and God is that source. And if a brother or sister is naked and in lack of daily food, and one of you tells them, go in peace, be warm, feel, and yet you didn't give them the things the body needs, what good is it? James 2:15, it's good, okay, love you. It's great. I can't help you. I got a closet full of clothes, but I don't even wear them. But you need them. I ain't going to give them. We do that sometimes. We'll rather go back and talk about something. You see them shoes here? Yeah, man, he need to go buy some. Y'all ain't going to say nothing, because that's what we do to our young people. We talk about their dress, but we won't help their dress. Leave that alone. The source of our love is God. And God's love is concrete and specific. First in the death and resurrection of Jesus Christ. And he repeatedly, continually shows us he loves us. In deeds of loving kindness, we are able to share with others in Christ's name. We love him because he first loved us. And if we're faithful, our love is seen in countless ways. How are they seen? Man, as we help families, as we tutor kids, as we serve as volunteers in youth and children's ministry, as we deliver meals sometimes made with kids' food basket, as we're praying for folks, as we're helping people through difficult times, we can do countless things to help and show God's love. God is the source of all love. And the miracle is this. The more you give, watch this, the more God gives you in return. The more you give, the more God gives you in return. The more you give, the more God gives you in return. See, here is what we must understand. Let's go back to the garden. Let's go back to the garden. Let's go back to the darkness. Oh, man. This is good, see. Oh, that's where we at, y'all. 21st century. Man. Am I going to be willing to say, man, I'm tired of sitting in darkness. I'm tired of being manipulated, not love right, not doing right, always cheating, always lying. Man, what can I do? I got to stop listening to the person that's getting me here. I got to go back to what got me in the first place. I got to go back to the place where I was sitting in light. I got to go back to the place that fed me everything that I need. So here's this. See, this is all us. Y'all knew I was going to have it. This is us right here. What's this, y'all? Lamp, right? We all know it's a lamp. Ain't no thing. Simple science, right? Now, we buy the lamp. It's good. It's beautiful. What's the purpose of the lamp? Light? It should. Light up. I bought it at the store, right? Christ died for it. He paid for it. Got it? Right? I bought it. I received it. Right? Man, that's beautiful. Oh, man, that's so good. Man, that's great. Hey, let me see. Man, why it ain't working? But I bought it. It posed to work. I got to do something else? What I got to do? Oh, got to go in. Okay. All right. I'm plugging in. This is the source. So I plugged it up to the source, right? So it worked, right? Hey, man, this faulty. What's wrong? Ain't what's wrong? It's in the source. I'm in church. I'm here. I'm saying I'm coming. Ain't got nothing. What we missing? Oh, it's something on the inside. Oh, it's something on the inside. So we got to actually put something on the inside. Holy Lord Jesus. Oh! And see, once we put something on the inside, while we sitting in the dark, God already knows we're all in the dark. He is able to transform us as we get in to his source. And now, as I continually come, the Lord said, now when you plug in and you simply stay connected to me, I am able to turn the inside of you on. I'm able to allow you to bring light to somebody else. I'm able to use you to touch the lives around you. But it is only when you are tapped in to the source. But it's not just coming to church. It's not just doing what pastor said just because pastor said it. But it's because I have a relationship with Jesus Christ. It's because I'm sitting before him like we learned in the Garden of Eden. This is face to face. Intimacy, Lord, you want. Intimacy, I'm naked before you. And I simply want to love you with everything that I have. All that I am, so that I might shine, that I might be the light for somebody else to see, for somebody else to see you and not me. They must look to you because you are the source. If we can only get back, if we can only get back to this perfect place in the garden that God designed us to be. But if we're honest, we have some different sources. Mike, let's read some. Read Romans chapter 5.
Fifth chapter. Therefore, since we have justified through faith, we have peace with God through our Lord Jesus Christ, through whom we have gained access by faith into this grace in which we now stand. And we rejoice in the hope of the glory of God. Not only so, but we also rejoice in our suffering, because we know that suffering produces perseverance, perseverance character, and character hope. And hope does not disappoint us, because God has poured out his love into our hearts by the Holy Spirit, whom he has given us. Verse 6, you see, at just the right time, when we were still powerless,
yes,
Christ died for the ungodly.
When we was in the dark.
Very rarely will anyone die for a righteous man. Through a good man, someone might possibly dare to die. Verse 8, but God demonstrates his own love for us in this: while we were still sinners, Christ died for us.
See, when we were sitting in the darkness, when we were turning our back and said, God, I don't care, he showed us and demonstrated the ultimate love. He died for us in spite of our ways, in spite of who we are, in spite of what we will do. He died for us that we might have the opportunity to be connected back face to face, the same opportunity to be lit. Somebody else can see that God is what is transforming us on the inside. If I simply allow him to be the source. But not just being the source, because now I must put in some work. And so now what pastor's talking about being unleashed. See, I can be unleashed and I can shine and I can be used by God's kingdom when we do and say what God tells us to say and do what he calls us to do. And that's simply be in love with him because he first loved us. He first loved us. He first loved us. See, young people, you must understand, he first loved you. What do I want you to walk away with today? First John 4:11. Be loved. If God loves us in this way, we also ought to love one another. Church, we must love each other. As I started at the beginning, that pastor was trying to share something with his congregation.
I want new hope to be a light for this community to see. In the midst of darkness, in the midst of troubled times, someone needs to see God's love. You might just be that light, that beacon that God is using to help transform somebody's life as you lead them to the source of all love. Thank you for hearing God on this morning. But now we're here. Now it's that time for us to respond. We simply want to open this time in our service to simply say this, that we love you, Christ loves you. And if you heard him speaking or tugging at your heart, we simply offer him to you today. We simply offer you the love of Christ today. As I, if I'm honest, try to be Christ-like. It's no perfect church. Because at least this ain't perfect, because I'm here and I'm imperfect. But we want to extend an open hand to you. So as our counselors will come, we want to receive you. As you hear God speaking on to your heart this morning, maybe you come, maybe it's your time to say, I've been coming, but I really haven't took advantage of being plugged in to the source. Maybe all I'm doing is hearing information, but I haven't took the time to apply to the point that I must put some work in myself that I can truly be connected. Is there one this morning? God is here this morning. Amen. Amen. That means everybody in the house is a believer. All connected. But this time, just before Pastor comes, I want to do something. I want to do a special time to come to the altar for our families, children's guests. Maybe if you look at this, if I'm honest, as we had earlier, maybe I can ask Mike to go in the background. I love that song that y'all was singing, and y'all come back and let's do that in the background. Because we have some people, even though you plugged in, that you know you need to be changed just a little bit more. Maybe you have someone you've been praying for. I hope you ain't waiting on somebody to get up, that you can come whenever you feel good. We just coming to the altar. One more time. I'm going to invite Pastor to come up and just share a prayer over us as we end our time. But truly, God wants you to ask the question, where is your source of love coming from? What do I need to change in my very life, my conversation? What I do outside of church, what I do inside of church?
Come like a rushing wind. Come like
me. Would I allow him to use me? Would I allow him to show me my mess? Will I allow him to break me, mold me, reshape me?
Come like never before.
For some of us, we've been doing the same thing 20 and 30 years. I know what it does. I've been doing it 20 years, and God said it's time to change.
I will stay here.
See, I'm not talking just to the believers, because see, John was talking to believers.
He was talking to individuals to say, I don't want you to be comfortable. But some of us has been comfortable for so long. He said, I'm talking to you, and I want to change you, because I simply want to love you in a capacity you've never seen before. But I don't want you to just take me for granted and do the same thing. Will you step up and be willing to change?
Until you change me.
God wants to change us.
Saints are here, Lord, not just those who are here at this altar, God, but everyone in this auditorium. God, we are on holy ground. We are in your presence. We come, God, as empty vessels. Lord, we are coming, and we're coming naked and unashamed. We are before you in your presence, Lord. We cannot hide. Lord, we may not openly confess all of what is wrong with us, but God, you already know what those matters are. And so, Father, we now humble ourselves in your presence. We just say to you, Lord, that we want you to change us. We realize, God, that the change that I can facilitate in myself, I can't keep it, God. It seems like when I get a couple of things right, I take a couple of steps backwards. God, I need you to do the change in me. I need you to do that lasting change, Lord. I need you to change my mind. Lord, I need you to change my heart. Father, I need you to change the way I think about some circumstances. And Lord, maybe perhaps the change needs to happen in me. I've been asking you to change everybody and everything else. But God, this request is for the change in me, God. Show me, Lord, in me, Father, what it is that you don't like. God, show me, Father, what it is that you want me to stop doing. Show me, Lord, who you want me to connect with, Father. And Lord, I just pray now, God, I ask that you would release these people this morning. Whoever has burdens, God, I pray that they feel you setting them free right now. For your word says, whom the Son sets free is free indeed. So Lord, I pray now for my brothers and sisters, God, that they would feel your freedom this morning, God. Freedom has come into our experience, and Lord, I pray now that you would open up blinded eyes, God, and that you would mend broken hearts, turn young men back to you, Father. Young women, Lord, give them a sense of value and worth, God, that they might know who they are and who they belong to, God. We'll stay here, God, that you might change us. And Lord, I thank you in advance today for what you're gonna do. I thank you in advance, God, for the doors that you will open. Father, I thank you, God, for how you would take people to higher heights, how you would take them further than they ever thought they could go, only because, God, they asked for you to change them. We thank you, Lord, for hearing this prayer. God, we know, Lord, that you hear us. We have no reason to doubt that you won't answer us. And so until we see it, God, we're going to say thank you. We're going to praise you. We're going to give you our hallelujah right now. We're going to tell you hallelujah right now. We're going to say thank you right now. In the name of Jesus. Amen. 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 Let's thank God today. Let's thank God for Brother Q.